Good afternoon, folks. My name is Michael Ayers, and I'm the Dean for Math and Science here at Forsyth Tech, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to our SciTech series. This is one of the real jewels of Forsyth Tech as far as I'm concerned. We've had over 34 SciTech lectures over the past several years, and we've had over 3,000 attendees. How many of you have attended one of these before? Okay, gosh, most of you. Excellent. So we're glad to have you back. This is a partnership between Forsyth Tech, BioNetwork, and the National Center for the Biotechnology Workforce. Today's lecture is being video streamed, so it's untelling how many millions of people around the world are watching our presentation. And the lectures are also recorded and posted to the National Center's website. I think you're in for a real treat today. I know the presenter well, but I'm not going to introduce her. We're going to let Mike Masoglia come up and do that. And Mike is the director for our grants office and does a great job bringing in extra dollars for our college, of which my division has benefited from a lot. So we thank Mike for that.
Thank you. Norma Quiñones is a learning consultant at Biogen responsible for managing learning programs for global quality training and development. Dr. Quiñones brings insights from more than 25 years in the pharmaceutical industry and academia. She has held diverse positions with responsibilities including leadership, curriculum, and program development. She is president of the Southeast chapter of GMPTEA, which is a not-for-profit organization of compliance professionals in the life sciences and other FDA-regulated industries. She also serves on the NC State University Hispanic Latino Advisory Council and is a member of the North Carolina Society of Hispanic Professionals. She has served on numerous national boards for Latino and migrant education, and in 2013 was recognized as an influential Latina in the field of education in North Carolina by HOLA from Fox 50 and NC State Extension programs. She was born and raised in Puerto Rico, where she earned her bachelor's in Hispanic studies before moving to North Carolina in 1996. She has since earned a master's with a double major in reading and writing and English as a second language, a master's in school administration, and a doctorate in administration and supervision with a sub-concentration in curriculum and instruction. She is married, has three children, and one granddaughter. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Norma Quiñones.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me well? Okay. I like to walk. Is that okay with you? Okay, I don't like to be behind this, but I prefer to walk and approach you. So like Mike, Grace, you know, so nicely introduced me. I'm Norma, you can call me Norma. I just happen to have a doctorate. That's all what it is. I like to start by saying that all of us have a story, and we all have a story to tell, right? It's our own story, isn't it? And sometimes you think that your story is not worth of sharing because it's only matter to you. But I have learned through life that I have learned a lot of stories from people that have inspired me and that have made a difference in my life. And not only have they inspired me, they have shaped me as a woman, as a professional, and as a person who likes to also motivate and inspire others to achieve and to succeed in life. So thank you for allowing me to share my story. And I hope that one day I will be there listening to your story, okay? With that said, I wanna start, if I can learn how to use this one, my story, my journey from higher education into the biopharmaceutical industry. And in there says Norma V. Quiñones. Well, let's go to my first stop. Once upon a time, I was born in the enchanted island of Puerto Rico. I am the oldest of four children, and I am what you will call the stereotypical Latina woman in Puerto Rico. What does that mean? means a lot of things to a lot of people, right? But what most important is what it meant to me and my family. And what that environment and what that perception shaped me and impacted who I am today. It was very obvious since I was born that gender roles were very well defined in my family. Women had a role and men had a different role. My father was not the exception. So I was a woman and he already had that vision of this is what she's gonna be. Well, little did he know that he was up to a surprise. Well, I don't wanna scare you, okay? The thing is that the one thing that we forget is that each of us come wired with that what? Personality, with dreams and hopes, intellect, challenges, right? My father didn't think of those things. He thought, no, she's gonna get married and she's gonna be a housewife and she's gonna raise children. And let me tell you something, I wanted to do that too, okay? It's not that I'm saying that that's wrong. I wanted it all. But there was something that did not match that equation. My father was like, no. He wanted to raise a lady, and I did a lot of things. So let me show you who I was and who I am through my pictures. So I captured those that keep me grounded, okay? I am Norma Victoria Cordova Escalera de Quiñones, because I am married to Mr. Roberto Quiñones. This is me when I was a year old. You see that little girl with that doll? Believe it or not, this is what keeps me grounded. When I think of who I am, I always go to that picture. And you can ask everyone in my family, and they're gonna tell you that that is the truth. I had the big picture of that in my hallway. I have one in my office, and I have it in my telephone, because that's who I really am. The rest is incidental. Okay, why do I say that? Because life has shaped me. Right there, as they call me in my house, Normita, because I'm little Norma, right? I didn't know any better. I was just a child with, you know, trying to grow and wanting to do what all of us at once, or once in a lifetime wanted to do. So why do I pick this one? What do you think they have in common? What do you think these pictures have in common? There's a thread in there. There's something that connects them. Family, thank you. Family. This is my family. This is my husband, my three children, and my granddaughter, right? The first here. These are my siblings and my mother. And these are my nephews. They're in Puerto Rico. This is my dad, rest in peace. And that's my family, my cousins, my aunts and uncles, and they play an important role in my life. And that's the person that I didn't know I could be. That's Norma with the doctorate, but no Normita. But when you put them all together, it's what? It's the same person, right? So how did I become Norma, Normita, and how did I travel from Puerto Rico to the United States, from being an educator to higher, from higher education into the biopharma? Do you have any idea how? Have you ever experienced this? Yes. Work. Determination. Amen. Yes. Discipline. So our next stop is how I started my career in education in Puerto Rico. Okay, we're going on a road trip, okay? So I went to school in Puerto Rico. I went to Catholic school from kindergarten through high school. I remember my first memory was when I was 3 years old. I begged my mom to take me to school. I really wanted to go to school because I was the youngest of all my cousins. And I thought that if I could go to school, that meant I was old enough and I can play with my cousins and everyone else. Well, my mom, I guess I drove her crazy, and she said, okay, we're taking you. So I went to school, then I went through high school, and I, at one point, I decided, well, I want to explore something else. So do you have here in North Carolina what you call the School of Science and Math, right? We had the same school in Puerto Rico. At age 15, I applied for that school. And fortunate for me, I was accepted to go to the School of Science and Math. I completed my high school in 2 years. I was 16 when I finished my high school. And not only that, I took all the advanced courses. We still have those, right? So when I finished with my first year of college. So I was 16, finishing high school, and I went to university, and I made it to the second year of university. I was not ready for that. I was a child, literally a child. Then I went to college. I have a bachelor's degree in Hispanic studies, but that was not the one that I really wanted to pursue. Remember what I told you about my background, my family, the gender role, remember? That was the first accident in my life, going to college. I was accepted into the pre-law program in Puerto Rico. I always said I was gonna be an attorney, always. I did all this research, I read a lot. But my father told me, no, you're not gonna be a lawyer. You're a woman and you're gonna get killed. And I said, what? So I could not afford going to college by myself, so I needed my dad's money, seriously. So I said, so what is the easiest thing I can do? I love literature. That was, for me, just very easy. I said, oh, I study Spanish. What did I do? I went to and pursued an undergrad in Hispanic studies, then another master's degree. I didn't include that one there. I didn't think it was relevant. I had 3 master's degrees, actually. You only need one. Okay, let me get that straight out there. So I did my master in Hispanic studies, and then I fell in love and I married. And then what happened? I worked as a teacher in Puerto Rico. At age 19, I was teaching high school. Imagine that. I don't know how I did it. But I did teach Spanish to high school students, and I loved them. Until today, those former students communicate with me. And then the United States of America, the adventure begins. When you're at that age of 22, when you get married, you think the United States is this big adventure. You have no clue what's going to happen. You are really clueless. I was. I thought it was like in the movies. I thought that there were main 3 states in the United States, New York, California, and Florida. And I was like, wow. And then when my husband said, no, we're going to Texas, I say, Texas, holy cow. So we made it to Texas. So how do I start? Places I've been. And this is all connected. I promise you, they all disconnect. So first off was Texas. I had to learn everything. Everything to me. I didn't speak English when I moved to America. I didn't know the culture. I didn't know anything. I only thought it was like the movie, seriously speaking. So I had to learn from the beginning that no, this is not Puerto Rico. No, I'm not Mexican. And it's nothing against being Mexican. No, I am not undocumented. I have a U.S. citizenship because I was born as a U.S. citizen. But I didn't know how to explain that to people because I didn't speak English. So no one could put me, you know, on a place. So that was hard. So I had to learn everything. I had to learn the innuendos of the language. I remember someone said once, stick around. You know what that means, right? Stick around. What do you think I did? Let's say they want me to stick around. It did happen. Because I didn't know. I mean, I was learning a language that he was doing. He said, is that something weird in this country? Anyway, unlike that, many other things. Then and all of this happened because my husband was an engineer and he was granted a scholarship to pursue his master's degree. That's why we moved here. So then from Texas, we went to New Jersey. I said, God, I need to learn English. So I went to the community college at night and I took ESL courses to learn English with a French teacher. So imagine me learning English with a French accent. It was something. But hey, I had to do it one way or the other. So I had to learn. And then I went to New Jersey. I said, I got to work. I was a certified Spanish teacher in Puerto Rico. But to my surprise, in New Jersey, it didn't mean anything. Because at that time, it was not reciprocal, my certification. So what happened? What do you think I did? I had to start all over again. I had to go back, and 2 years after, you know, trying to learn the whole thing, I was able to get my certification as a Spanish teacher, but I had to go back to school. Then Maryland happened. Maryland was not what I expected. Very expensive, nice place. Everything happens there. And I was completely lost. I was really trying to catch up with the world, trying to catch up with the country, learning the rules, the regulations, everything. It was kind of hard for me. Then after that, my husband decided we need to go back home. So that was a big hiatus of 4 years. I went home. I needed to reconcile myself. I needed to bring back myself. I needed to see who I was, because I was literally lost. And not lost because I didn't know how to drive around. Me, Norma, I was lost. And I had to go home. And so we did. So it took us 4 years to realize that, okay, I think we're ready. We came back, we went to Florida. My husband has worked for all his life for pharmaceutical industry. But he did not give me my job. Let me clarify that, okay? I earned this on my own. So we went to Florida, and I'm not going to advertise it, but this is what happened. He was working at that time for Eli Lilly. You know that's one of the pharmaceuticals, right? And all of a sudden, I said, you're going to France. I said, going where? I'm just learning to live here in America. You're going to ship me to France? Well, there we go. They ship us, the whole family, to France. And again, we had to start all over again. But I decided, I'm not working here. I'm not doing this again. I'm coming back home. And then they wanted to ship us to Spain. I said, nope, we're not going anywhere. We're going back home. So we went to Florida again. From Florida, then happened what? North Carolina. North Carolina, I told my husband, this is home. And I knew it was home because the day I came to visit my husband, he has been working here for YF at that time. I came to visit him. I got off the airport, the old airport that we had in RTP. And I remember taking the little bus that takes you to get your rental car. And I was the only person on that bus. And the guy looked so seriously. He looked into my eyes, and he said, welcome home. It was like something has taken a deep root in my heart. And I'm like, oh, my gosh, no. And I said, no, I'm not from here. And he looked again and said, welcome home. I say, if you say so, I'm not going to argue. So from there, I started to explore the idea of staying in North Carolina. It's been 19 years since I first came to North Carolina, okay? And this is where my journey begins for you. And I wanted you to learn the background, because it does have an impact. And like I say, you all have a story, and you need to put it together so it will make sense. So why North Carolina? Because that's where my husband got a job. That's as simple as it is, right? So I said, what am I going to do here? I had three kids. They were little. My husband was working. I didn't have the certification. And one day I ventured. I was in the hotel. I said, they have to have schools. I went to Sanford. Let me say that. How many of you know where Sanford is? Lee County. So I got the yellow page. I said, okay, they gotta have books. I mean, school. So I looked for the county office of the school. I said, well, let's just go on a tour. So we drove. I called. I went in. I just wanted to learn. I needed something to do. Well, little did I know, the director of ESL came down. The secretary said, we have someone here to speak Spanish. Like, that's a miracle. Like, that's, you know, a big gift. I said, I don't know what's up. But she, wait here. Can you wait? Yeah. I'm not leaving until next week, so yeah, I can wait. Well, anyway, what happened? She came down. Do you speak Spanish? She started interrogating me. I said, what is she doing? And my kids were like, Mom, you want to go home? Well, no home. Hotel, honey. Well, without knowing me, she said, do you want to work for us? I said, what? Do you want to be an ESL teacher? I didn't even know what was that. English as a second language I learned later on. So I told my husband I knew he was going to be stationed here for 1 year, and I was going to be in Florida with the kids. So I thought, hey, why not? You know, maybe 1 year together will help us. So we went, traveled, did whatever we needed to do. I came back. This woman hunted me like a witch. And I mean that, really. I'm like, I did not want to come back. But anyway, I said, well, maybe it was meant to be. So I came. She offered me the job, and there we go. And I said, well, I have a baby. My daughter was 3 years old, my youngest one. I said, I don't know where I'm going to leave her. Don't worry. We're going to find a place for her. So they set everything up for me. I said, oh, my gosh. So that's how my adventure started with ESL and the migrant world. How many of you know what migrant is? How many of you know what migrant world is? Migrant student? I started as an ESL teacher here in Sanford. And my students were migrant. They were all migrant. And they didn't know English. They didn't speak any English. So I had to teach them English as a second language. And I needed also to teach them something else other than the language. What do you think it was? How to survive in America. And what else? The most thing, the most important thing that people most likely ignore in life.
Believe in yourself.
Amen. That they could do it too. That even though this was not their country, that they didn't speak the language, they too could do it. So I adopted those children like they were mine because I identified myself with them because I was so lonely when I first came here and I knew this. So that's what I did. So I became a ESR teacher, migrant. Well, luckily for me, immediately I got there. I said, oh my God, these people are rich. 2 weeks after in the job, they told me, do you want to pursue a master's degree? I said, what? I already have one. We're going to pay for it. I'm like, what? Well, I said, why not? If it's free, you know, and they're going to offer it at the county office, why not? That was the second master's degree that he mentioned. That's my master's degree in reading and writing with a double major in English as a second language. So there I go. Apparently, I did something right. Because like 2 years after, I got a call from the Department of Public Instruction. I didn't know anyone there. You see, that's my DPI part. I said, well, we're going to have a new program, teacher on loan. We're going to open the new section, closing the achievement gap. How many of you remember that, closing the achievement gap? I was one of the original members of that section. So they wanted me, Dr. Elsie Leek at that time, I don't know if you know her. She was the assistant dean, interview me, and I heard from her, and I got the job. I didn't know why was this happening, but it did. And let me tell you, I really loved it. After I finished that master, I went on to pursue another master's degree because then I thought, well, I don't see any Spanish or Latina school principals in here in Stanford. And I thought, well, maybe I could be one. So I said, well, let me apply. So I went to NC State. I got a, not that I'm promoting then, okay, that's not it. So I got accepted, completed my master in school administration. And after being several years at DPI, and then I had become a permanent employee, I decided I want to be a school administrator. So I went, and I ended up going where? To a high school again, where I started when I was 19. So wonderful. I had a great experience. But honestly, I had children at home, and I was worried about my hours. But if I needed to do it, I had to do it. So one day I got a call from my former director from DPI. I said, we're going to have a position. I would like for you to apply. And I'm like, okay, why not? So I apply, and fortunately for me, I got the job. And at that point, I realized everyone in here who's a director have a doctorate, and I don't have one. So I thought, if I want to survive and succeed in this environment, what do I need? Amen. So I could say, okay, let's do it again. By that time, I already had 3 master's degrees. I had 3 kids in school, my husband traveling. I was insane, I had no life. And I'm gonna tell you this, I slept 4 hours for 13 years in a row. And you talk about commitment and discipline, that's what it took from me and a lot of other things. But I did. So I worked for DPI shortly after, I always go shortly after, that means 2-3 years, okay? Not just months. A position in the federal programs came available as a director and I was encouraged to apply. So I applied, I thought I'm not gonna get it. But lo and behold, I got it. So that opened a different dimension in my life. Because then I started working at the national level. I was managing federal programs for North Carolina. I started to meet Congress people, legislators, senators. I started to meeting people who made a difference, meeting people who had the power to make a difference in our lives. So to me, that was an opportunity like, yes, we can do this. Yes, we can help people. Yes, we can help all of us. And I can learn. So I did that for 7 years. And again, life happened. Then someone gave me a call. I don't know why I had this ability of people calling me. I said, we have a position at NC State. Would you like to apply? And I said, why not? I always say, why not? Because I always think I'm not going to get it. Honestly, I think I'm never going to get it. So I went through all this interview. I said, no, it's not going to happen. Guess what? I got it, right? So I got the job. I started as a lateral entry coordinator and director of student services. But then a few months after that, they had a position as an assistant dean, and again, invited to apply. I applied, and I got it. So I became an assistant dean, and then 2009 happened, and my world crashed. Since I started, my life has gone all this high, right? You know what the bell curve is? Going up, 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 up. I was at the top of my game, right? I was already working on my doctorate. I was an assistant dean. What is what I want? I had it done. And then I got the call. My dean called and said, "We have a problem." And I said, "Oops, what did I do this time?" Well, I didn't do anything. We had a financial crisis. Who remember 2009? Well, the university had a 20% deficit. And assistant deans were under contract. They're not permanent employees. And they're employees at will. You know what that means, right? That if they don't have the funding, they cannot hire you. So she was very nice. She said, "I can keep you as a part-time employee." And I said, "You know, I have full-time commitments. I cannot do this." So I kept working, hoping that a miracle would happen. And the miracle did happen, not the one that I anticipated. So I lost my job. And then what? All my life I've been on this continuum, going up, up, up. And they had taken the floor under me. And I made one of the biggest mistakes of my life, thinking that who I was determined by my career. That's when I went back to that picture, the one that I show you. I had to find myself again. I need to say, okay, this is not me. A job will be here today, maybe not tomorrow. I do need a job, don't get me wrong, okay? I need to pay my bills, that's not what I'm saying. But I needed to say, okay, this is who I am. And what do I have? So I started, okay, starting backwards, what I don't want to do. I'm a person who takes copious notes. I've been in school all my life, so I had to write everything. So I started taking notes, notes, okay. And I noticed that everything that I wrote is, I don't want to do this, this, and that. So I said, okay, so I don't want to do this, so what do I want to do? And it was like an epiphany. I look at my husband, and I said, I want to work in the industry, in the biopharmaceutical industry. Oh my gosh, it went away, right? I told you I was not good at this. This is the one course I didn't take, okay? So then I had what I didn't want to do, so I developed a list of the things that I knew I could do. My skills, my experience, my degrees, the people I knew. That's very important that you get that too, okay? Places I'm not willing to go, and the things that I was not ready to sacrifice. So the first time in my life, I realized this is not just another job. This is a career, and that's a big difference that you need to understand when you are out in the market. This is not just a job. We all can get a job, but if you want to make a career, you have to work hard. You need to put a different kind of effort and a different type of mentality. So I had to do that. So I started becoming very deliberate and very focused. And I'm like, no, no, no. Or yes. Then my decision to explore the biopharma industry came along, and I started to research. And I read. I said, okay, I think I'm ready to have a job. Then I started applying, and I thought, oh, it's going to happen. Remember, always people call me to apply, invited me, I always got the job. Nobody called me. And I'm like, oops, this is not good. I was not used to that. And I was very scared, and I went into a depression. And people don't like to talk about these things, but it's real. And you need to acknowledge that you're human and that that is not the end of the world. You need to pick yourself. You need to make an effort. That's why you have family. Remember I showed you that? I had to go back to my family. I needed the strength. Remember I went back to Puerto Rico 4 years? Had to do the same thing. Had to go back to me, who I am. So that really sustained me. So I have very unsuccessful job application, and I'm not lying when I tell you that I applied to more than 100 places. A lot. Think about if that's discouraging or not. When you have 3 kids, 2 in college, I was finishing my doctorate at that time, and I had bills to pay, and I had built a career for 25 years. how on earth this happened to me? That was not part of that equation. But that was the big miracle, like I mentioned before. So I thought, oh, I could be what? A volunteer. Very soon I understood that you had to volunteer with a purpose. One thing is charity, which I always done, but you had to volunteer with a purpose. Why? Why do you volunteer with a purpose, aside from the one that you volunteered to help? Take you seriously? What else? Meaningful to you? What was the thing that I was looking in that opportunity? Say that again. I was looking at careers. I wanted to earn experience. I said, okay, you're not gonna call me, you're not gonna hire me, I'm gonna go to you. And I need to learn from you so that I can make that transition. Well, I started writing letters and letters and letters, and again, no one answered. I said, okay, I need to know people in the industry. My husband had work, but I didn't want to bother him because I knew it was going to haunt me for the end of my life. And I never promised, never asked him, do you know anyone? I said, no, that's not me. Talk about pride, right? Talk about my father. I think I was his daughter, right? But anyway, the thing is this. After all of this, I said, I'm going to start writing letters. And I realized that they do internships, but they're paid for. And at that time, no one had money. They were hiring freeze everywhere. So I'm like, okay, I need to volunteer. I need to earn the experience. And in between, I got two offers to be a high school principal, one in Durham and one in Wake County. And I say no. And my husband was like, okay, do you want to explain? And I'm like, no. But anyway, fortunately for me, that's when Biogen, at that time it was called Biogen Aitik, and I'm not trying to promote them, but I need to give them credit. That was a leap of faith. They allowed me to complete my doctorate practicum at Biogen. I remember the day I walked through those doors. Honestly, it was love at first sight. I told my husband, I'm not leaving this place. You know, I went through a whole process, you know, of interviews, security clearance, everything, like I was going to be working there being paid. I did my doctoral practicum, and very soon I learned that that was a highly regulated environment, not what I was used to. We had regulations in the federal programs, nothing like the industry. It's completely different, a different culture, a different world, everything. Talk about relearning your life again. And let me tell you something, very soon I understand that people are not gonna wait for you to teach you and tell you, no, no, no. You're gonna be trained and you need to keep moving. Because there's work to do. But fortunately for me, I always find very good people. So I made it into the biopharmaceutical industry. And I say, what am I going to do to stay here? There's no money. And I was told that, no commitment. So what I did was, okay, I signed a contract. Well, not a contract, an agreement that I was going to complete my doctoral practicum for 6 months. Well, 6 months were coming up. And I was not applying for a job because I didn't want to leave Biogen. And my husband was like, what do you want to do? I have 1.5 more year. I didn't mention that. And I'm going to make a sort of like a forced tour, like we call in literature. I'm going to force a topic in here. The one thing that helped me and allowed me to be able to do my practicum is the fact that my husband and I, all our life, have saved money. We save money. That was what we learned. We pay us first, okay? And then we pay the world. It's not that we were not paying everyone else. We always do that. But acquiring that discipline. So because of that, I was able to say, okay, I can work for free. Well, not for free. I had to do my practicum. Fortunately for me, I was sponsored by manufacturing. I had no idea what manufacturing was. I said, what does that is? But I had to learn. You know David Satie? He was my mentor. He took a leap of faith. Until today, I'm very loyal to him. He will tell you that. Because he believed that I could do it. They had to develop these trainings. They had a hiring freeze, doctoral practicum. They taught me. I did it. Out of 50 units that they did it to do in 1 year, a whole global department, guess how many I did in 6 months? By myself. And now I'm going to brag. 50. The whole company, all sites globally, okay? Me, little Norma from Puerto Rico, in 6 months, never working in the industry. How many of you think I did in 6 months? I did 25 on my own, so the word spread. They're like, she did 25, and the rest still not finished, or they're still working. I'm like, well, I didn't have nothing else to do, so, you know, they had other commitments. So I was determined, I'm going to learn. I'm going to do this, whatever it takes. So that, the word spread, caught the attention of many people. I got offered a contract. That was my Merry Christmas present. So I got called into this office. I said, we cannot. I thought, they're going to let me go. No, I said, I want to stay even for free. I was willing to stay 6 more months. I mean, not for free, you know, under the practicum. Because I was paying the university. Remember that. I was paying registration to be there. So what happened then? Because I did that, I was committed. Then I was offered a contract. And I'm like, oh, my gosh, I could not believe it. So I was very, very fortunate. But I worked very hard. I really did. And I earned it. And I'm not that I'm bragging, but I need to acknowledge to I need to acknowledge my successes, and so do you. Because people here, you have to be humble. Humble doesn't mean you have to brag. They're two different things. But you need to acknowledge what you have accomplished and be proud of that, because that's what's going to take you down the road, because that's what's going to help you build your self-esteem and earn that security that I can too do this. Well, 2 months after I was on the job, under contract, one of the ladies from the training department got married and moved to California. I say, heaven and earth had come together. But the position was not something I could do. So guess what I did? I wrote a proposal, redefining the role based on the needs that I saw they had, because they could not hire anyone. I said, you know, this position can do A, B, C, and D. And I'm like, oh my God, this is a long shot. But hey, what did I do? I had nothing to lose. So I went in, I said, who do I need to talk to? So I contacted, I was guided by people, and I made an appointment with the vice president. I didn't know the guy, but I said, I had nothing to lose. So he was very gracious. He listened to me. I sent him a copy. He didn't say anything. He said, you need to give this to the manager. I said, oh my gosh. He said, ask her to call me. Well, very fortunate for me what happened. What do you think it happened? I'm smiling. They liked the proposal. So they went in and they look at the job description and they align it. And then I applied like everyone else. I got an interview and I got the job. I made it to Biogen in 10 months flat as a permanent employee, okay? And then my journey started. Oh my God, oh my God, I'm losing this. Okay, so now I had to establish a new career in biopharmaceutical industry, highly regulated. I have various roles within that company since 2010 when I started at Biogen as an employee, no, as a doctor of practicum. I have held 5 positions so far, so you can average 1 per year. So I was a doctor of practicum, right? I was a contractor. Then I was hired as an instructional designer. That was my first job. Then I was transferred to manufacturing, and I became a project manager. I was responsible for developing and aligning all the manufacturing competencies. So I had to do the competency-based training. You all know what that is, right? So I did the competency-based training for the entire manufacturing sites in North Carolina, Denmark, Cambridge, and everywhere we have affiliates. So I did that by myself. Of course, I have a team of people helping me. And there was me. There were times I say, am I really doing this? It's just so surreal. Shortly after, maybe a year or two, okay, another position happened. And then I applied. I got it. I came back to global quality. And a year and a half ago, I got promoted again, and I became a learning consultant. So I now manage global programs. So I make sure that everyone of my customers that I am assigned to, okay, not that I have ownership of them, I'm assigned to, I meet with them, I do needs assessment, I find out what are their training needs, what are their competencies, we look at the curricula, we establish the curricula, we find the people that are going to be part of that team that are going to help us identify the content. We identify delivery types. We deliver it. We identify the technology that is needed. and we make sure that it's globally aligned, and I cannot stress this a lot. And we make sure that it meets all the good manufacturing, all the GXP. And the GXPs are the good manufacturing, good clinical, good laboratory. All those good practices are what? The guidance of the industry, okay? And the other thing that I had to learn is that regulations change quite rapidly, and you need to adhere to those regulations. So that's what I had done in the last 6 years of my life. Well, 5 years, right? 2010, right? No, 2009. I'm getting old. I must be 100 now. No, just kidding. So 2009, became an employee, and that's what I've been doing. And right now, my goal is to go back to school. I want to earn a certification in regulatory affairs because I love the field. And I would like to pursue a career in regulatory affairs within Biogen. And I'm not saying to leave training. I want to be able to implement what I learn in what I do. So that's where I am right now. And for me, honestly, I want to leave you with this. It's very hard to come to a country, like I mentioned before, not knowing anyone. But it's like any other thing in life. When you have a will, there is a way, right? And you need to be faithful to that. You have to be willing to sacrifice. It's not a magic formula. It's really not. You know, people want things very easy. And maybe I was guilty of that at some point. But when I was studying, some of my friends were watching television. They were going shopping, and they invited me. I said I had to go to school. And I was hardly criticized. But guess what happened? I finished. I'm still here. Now I can go shopping. Now I can watch television, whatever I want to do, right? But I owe it to myself. I had to do that. Because the one thing I learned, that time is going to pass you by no matter what. So you might as well do something productive with it. Okay? I do have my hobbies. I have my passions. But my job right now is my north. Because of that, I can help others. It's not what it defines me, but it gives me purpose. So I just want you to know that whatever you are right now, start thinking of your future. I don't do the 5-10 years thing like they ask you. I never do that. I can't, because it gives me anxiety. I just thinking like, okay, what is it? Beginning and end. So that's what I have been doing for this time. And I hope that with what I share with you, you can do something. Or ask, how can I do this? How can I implement this kind of life or that kind of journey? And that has been my journey. And there's a lot of things in the industry. My goal is to continue to work. And if you make it to the industry, don't stop in one place. There is a way. Once you make it there, that's when you start your other way. Because you need to know, you're here today, you can move here, here. Be prepared. That's what you need to do, and be willing to learn, and be accountable. You have to be accountable. So with that, I want to thank you. That's it. Very simple.
Norma, will you take questions?
Yeah.
Okay, for a few minutes. Okay, just stay there. We're gonna take the mic around and rove. So, questions. Don't be shy, please. Can you introduce yourself too? Thank you.
I'm Michael Monti, and I'm a student at SciTech. This is my second semester here. Mm-hmm. And I'm African, I'm Ghanaian, I'm from Ghana. I've been in the United States for just about 11 years. Now, like you said, I don't like to seem like being presumptive or being bragging or something. But before I came here, I had a degree in economics, and I had gone back to do a master's in economic policy management. And my experience was all in government. So when I got here, and I wasn't qualified to work for the government, I was in a bind. because private companies won't recognize my experience. Mm-mm. And I can't work for the government, so I had to go to school. And for the past 8 years, I've been going to school. The problem is I've changed a couple of things every now and then. And so I start something, I don't finish, and then I switch, you know. But the question I want to ask you is, and it's because I realize that there are authorities from SciTech, and I think it's something which needs to be addressed. Along the way, when you came from Puerto Rico, did you have a place where you could walk in, present them with what you have, and let them help you figure out how to navigate the new place? Because that's been a challenge for me. I have gone to UNCG, A&T, Guilford Tech, you know, try to find a place where I could go for somebody to tell me that, look, this is your background. If you, these are the alternatives available to you. You know, you could try this and try that or try that. So you could pick something out of your interest and then you have a clear understanding of the picture ahead of you. Because I've been like knocking my head against the wall, you know, till I feel like now I'm figuring out a way. And I'm like, I mean, I could have done so many things along the way, but I didn't know. And I keep people who are new, when they talk to me, I keep telling them, well, what I can. But I think that the institutions which a lot of foreign students fall onto, which especially the community colleges, could be of great help if they could develop some outfit which could help foreign students, you know, navigate the new country, adopted country. It would be of great help. It's a need which people don't realize it. And the interesting thing is the new guys who come, they are a bit, you know, they are not comfortable in the system. They can't articulate their problems. And so they walk around and nobody seems to help them. But they are great potentials which could be of good use to any institution. So that's my question, trying to figure out if any office could help you shorten your journey. Thank you.
In my case, no, there was no one that helped me figure that out. I had to do that on my own. The one thing that helped me is the fact that I knew what I was and what I did. Remember when I mentioned I went to New Jersey and I wanted to teach? So for me, it was like, well, in Puerto Rico, in order to be a teacher, you had to have a licensure. So, and someone has to certify me. And I in Puerto Rico was the Department of Public Instruction too. So I started to doing research. I started to reading, okay, where do I go to get my certification evaluated? Because I knew something had to happen, but I didn't know what was needed. So it was something that I had to do on my own. So I had to literally develop this strategy of writing down. Remember I told you I take copious notes and I develop lists? I still do. Writing the list. But the one thing that I had to do was first, what is the first step? For me, it was learning the language. Where do I go to learn the language? Okay. So again, the phone book, computers were not as good as they were right now, but I had to learn. Going to places, I went to the county offices and start asking questions, getting information. My husband, colleague's wife helped me in terms of telling me the addresses of the places where I needed to go, not telling me what I needed to do, but at least giving me directions. So I had to have my own packet and build my case very shortly in the like I call it, the Mickey Mouse English that I used to speak, because it was hard. So unfortunately for me, no. But what you just said, I know there is an issue and continues to be an issue, not just for you or for me, for students right now in the school system. Because that happened to my own children. Fortunately for me, they had me. And again, I'm not bragging. That's not what I'm doing, okay? The reason why I'm saying that, because I've already been through the whole process, so I know, I navigate it. And the one thing is you need to start building relationships. And when you start something, you need to finish it. That's me. I don't jump from one thing to the other. Mm-mm. I didn't have time to do that. I had to begin and end. And then it's like word of mouth. Okay, I go here. Where else do I need to go? Okay, I went to the next place. Okay, what else? So that's what it happened. But I had to do it on my own. To tell you that I had any entity, no, unfortunately not. But so, now I know how to do it.
So I just, you know, I work for the Economic Workforce Development, and we have an international center. And that's part of Foresight Tech, and you know that's a great place to go to for international people to go for support. And so I can say that's in our division, and you know that would be open to you. And I just wanted to ask you if you knew Hakeem Sam from your home country, Dr. Hakeem Sam. Doesn't ring a bell? Mm-hmm. Okay,
he's and a sir, to your
good
point,
friend of mine.
I'm
actually.
Sorry, it's very easy now to. It's easier than before for me. You know, 20 something years ago when I came here. It's a lot easier. You go into the internet, you just log in, and even you do Google Translate. Again, I'm not promoting them, but you can do that now. You know, I still do it, but it's a lot easier, and there's a lot of institutions that are more aware of the need.
Questions? Questions? Thank you, Michael. Thank you. Questions? There we go. There's a question.
Hi, Dr. Norman. Thank you for sharing your experience. When I hear your story, I just think I'm following your way. Because let me introduce my situation. My first language is Chinese, and I also get my graduate school master degree in China. And I, with my husband, come here since 2012. So I'm on the early stage of my career and knife chasing. So I have struggled with language speaking. Mm-hmm. I'm struggling with the culture, and I have to learn a lot of things and not much friends, and I have to take care of my children. So during this period, can you give me some suggesting how to handle this? Sometimes, like I'm frustrated. It's because it's very hard.
You want the truth?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for sharing that, because when I was going through that, I could not even
understand.
I could not even share my story with anyone. I understood you. I said, when I was in your place, right there, when I came here that I didn't speak English, mm-hmm. I didn't know. I mean, I was depressed. I had three kids. My husband was working, and I became very resentful. I resented him. And those are the things we don't speak in here, because we want to tell people, you know, these are your private things, you know, you don't talk about those things, but that's a reality. I resented him. I said, I left everything behind. My family, my life, who I was, because you wanted to pursue your dream and your graduate school. And I married him. No one forced me, but it was very difficult for me. What I do know that helped me was my faith. I went back to church. I'm going to be very honest. My faith, my prayers, calling my mother, calling my siblings, that family support, knowing that I was not alone, not physically, but, you know, I had a support at a distance, you know, but I knew that I had someone that I can return to. So that held me up. And I had three kids that I needed to raise. They could not see me to be so vulnerable because I was mommy, you know, and mommy is supposed to be strong. Mommy is supposed to be the one helping us get, you know, do everything. The one thing I learned, and I will share this with you with my open heart, and you know, we are human. And as human, we feel and we're vulnerable. There were times that I cry. There were times that I didn't know that I could do it the next day, but I did get up. I got up. And I said, I had three kids. I need to learn this. I'm better than this. And the one thing that I had to do was to belief that I could do it. And then find the places and find the courage to do it. Every day was a new day. And I didn't know that I was going to do it, you know, because not learning English, not knowing English, being alone, not able to communicate, needing a translator to buy a car. To buy a car, I needed a translator. And I don't know whether or not they were being honest or not. I had no guarantee that they were communicating what I was saying. So it was a leap of faith. So in my country, say agarrar el toro por los cuernos. That means grab the horn, the bull by the horns. So that's what I did. And just one day after the other, I created a notebook. And I learned language by sounds. I love music. So what I did was, okay, let's listen to the music. I watched television. I remember watching Laverne and Shirley, that show. Yes, I don't know if you know that show. I said, I had no clue what they meant. So I got my dictionary. I got my words. This is me going at night at the community college, which a French teacher, like I told you. And I'm like, holy cow, what am I going to do? So, and then I started buying these little books, story books, like the kids' books that have English and Spanish. And I started correlating. And I'm like, oh my God, oh my gosh. And then I put myself on the line. I went to the grocery store, and I would go to the person. How do you say this in English? I learned basic one. And then say it again. They might thought that I was a moron or retarded. I don't care. You know, I say, can you say it again? And I will close my eyes until I recorded it in here. So that what I did, it was right here, and immediately I wrote it. And then in Spanish. And then the way I heard it, that's how I wrote it. I could care less how it was really written in real language. But when I heard it, I could recognize it. So then I did that homework. So, and started to read magazines, newspaper. I didn't touch books because they were too hard for me. And I remember, I'm going to make this as a joke, but it was really serious. That's when I knew that I was, oh my God, in trouble. I remember watching this soap opera because I watched everything in the world. It was called Another World. And I remember someone saying, well, they're going to heal. And I thought it was high heels. I love shoes, right? And I love high heels. I say, heal, but I don't see no shoes. I had to make the connection. They were sick on a bed. Oh, heal. Look in the dictionary. He's healing. Está sanando. So my advice to you, okay? Right now, there are many opportunities. Take English courses, as many as you can. Start with the basic ones.
I will.
Okay? Start with the language. And then I learned this because I became an English language teacher. Imagine that, you know? Writing came later. First is the oral language. You need to earn proficiency. The oral language has to come first. And you earn that by listening, repeating, and reading. You need to read, 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 and read. Because believe it or not, when you read, you are acquiring what? The writing what? Conventions, right? So it's becoming, it's sort of like, I don't know how to explain it, but it's sort of like it's recording in your brain. So you do that. And then you start writing. You're going to make mistakes. I wrote English with Spanish syntax. Go figure. I got a lot of red marks on my papers. So that's what I would advise you. Don't be embarrassed. Don't feel bad. If you need to cry, cry. I do a lot of that. Look at me now.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Any other questions? Yes.
Hello. First, thank you so much for sharing your stories. It's very inspiring.
Oh, thank you.
My name is Diana.
Diana?
Yes, Diana.
Are you from Puerto Rico?
No, I'm actually from Ecuador.
Ecuador, because that's the yes. Indian from Puerto Rico, the Caribbean. That's why I'm asking. Los Taínos.
Well, thank you. My question to you is, I know that you're saying that when you felt lost, you would go back home to your family. Mm-hmm. Now, what would you do in the case where you don't have that support?
Okay. Believe it or not.
Like, I do have two kids and a husband, but I mean, like, you know.
You don't need to get into details. That's not what we're here for. What would you do? I will find a place in here. Do you know? I went back to church. I'm sorry. I'm not trying to do, but that's my honest truth. I went back to church, and I pray, and I try to find people who spoke Spanish, even if they were not from Puerto Rico. And I started to build a community. by referral. You know, the church is a good place to go, at least for me, it was my safe haven. So they had communities, and they had like Hispanic groups, and they had different groups. I know they're Korean groups, they're Haitian, they're from different, I mean, right nowadays, there's, the thing has really evolved in North Carolina. When I came back here 20 years ago, it's a different thing. But right now, there are a lot of more support systems. So through churches, through communities, through organizations, you start building friendships. You start building that network, and you need to, you start nesting. You know what is a nest? You know, that's how I call it. You start nesting, and you put your cheeks together. And those become your family. We have that. All my friends are Latinos that I have met in here, and they have become the uncles and the aunts and the family members that we don't have in here. I know it's hard because my mom is a phone call away, but she's not next to me. And there are things that as a daughter I'm not going to share with her because I don't want her to be worried. We're 3,000 miles away from the ocean, you know, she cannot come back here. So I cannot do that. So I would advise you to do several things. Find out what you want to do. What are the things that you need? Sorry, what is the support that you need, right? If you don't have a lot of people near you, start reading books that will help you grow and learn. Get yourself to do something. Don't stay put. Don't do that. Because if you become static, if you become static, that's the worst thing that you can do. When I lost my job, I told my husband, do not allow me to be paralyzed. Don't. But Bill, be sociable. I'm very sociable. I know a lot of people. And that's what people say, you know everyone. Well, it came as a need. That's the result of not being from here. So if you want to talk later, I can share you some other things, okay?
Well, thank you. I appreciate
You're
your
welcome.
Time.
Anybody else? Oh, there we go. Okay. Thank you.
My name's Arizima, and I just want to ask, how long did you live in France, and did you enjoy it?
Holy cow. I hope no one would ask that. I'm going far away. We were in France for a year. Did I enjoy France? I enjoy Europe. And France was one of the things that my husband was there for 2 years. And the first year we were going back and forth, my kids and I. The second year I had no choice to go and leave permanently. France is a different country than what I expected, okay? Although it's a Roman language and I took Latin in college and I thought, oh, it's gonna be a piece of cake because I can, you know, sort of like defer the language, baloney. That's not true. It's a completely different, to me, I always say to me, I cannot generalize. And this was 1995, okay? So things change with time, okay? And people change. But France, at that time, my experience was that the fact that I was a US citizen, I had no chance to survive in there. You know, in the sense that, historically, I had learned that there has been, you know, these things that happen between countries, and you think, oh, they're just things from the books. People remember. And when they see you, they think you're the ambassador of the country. I'm not the ambassador of the United States of America, nor Puerto Rico. You know, I'm just Norma. So again, I did enjoy going to Europe. It gave me the access to travel all over Europe and visit all the countries. And I had been in Europe before, so I pretty much knew what I wanted to go. I had to homeschool my kids because I had three kids with me, my kids. So I had to homeschool them. I met my husband's colleagues. They were French. They were very nice and very welcoming. But I live in Strasbourg. I don't know if you know where Strasbourg is. It's the Alsace region. And you know the United Nations, they had their counterpart that in Strasbourg. So it's a very political place. It's very like Washington in here. That's what Strasbourg is. And people do not open that easy to you. So I had nothing against Strasbourg. I love learning the culture, the food, the chocolate, all that kind of thing. I really enjoyed it. But I struggled. I did struggle because I was not able to connect at all, period. I could not, and I tried, and I thought it would be easier for me. When I realized that I could speak Spanish, I remember I can speak Spanish in France. That's when things started to get better for me. But it was like 3 months for me, 3 months to the time that I was leaving. People there, oh, you're Spanish. I'm like, no, I'm Puerto Rican. So they didn't know the difference. So I had to explain Caribbean. Oh, which are the islands? So a whole history lesson had to happen. So that helped me. That helped me a lot, speaking Spanish while in France. I remember being stopped by people say, you don't speak English correctly nor Spanish correctly, because I went back and forth to English and Spanish, what we call Spanglish. And you know, I told them, that's none of your business. You know, I was so mad. I was speaking to my kids. How dare them come and tell me I cannot do that, you know? I'm talking to my kids. I can speak in any language I want. So France was hard for me, very hard. And maybe, you know, being fair to France, because I knew I was only going to be there for a year. That's another thing. I knew I was going to leave. I was not staying. Here, I knew I was going to stay to live. But that's different. Your mindset is different when you know you're here to stay. Why do you ask, if you don't mind me asking? What I did enjoy, like I said, it was the fact that I could travel all over Europe for free. And I learned a lot. That's culture that I always will have with me. And it helped me understand that the world is just one this little thing. People are people no matter where you are.
So, Norma.
We're done, right? Yes.
We're not going to take any more questions right now because they're going to close down the cameras. Mm-hmm. But. On behalf of the college, and on behalf of BioNetwork, and on behalf of the National Center, we want to thank you for sharing your journey today. Incredible journey, and very impressive. And I just wanted to have a show of hands of how many people actually have come to the United States and have left another country that are in the audience today. Interesting. Okay, did you find it useful and helpful? Okay, how about a round of applause for Dr.
Quiñones? Oh, you don't
have
to, but thank you. No. Thank you for being here. Make sure you build your stories.
And Norma, on behalf of the college, we do have something for you. We tend to reward great performances. If it had been not a great performance, we wouldn't give you this.
Oh, Lord.
Just kidding.
Thank you very much.
Let's have a look at it. It's for your wall in your office. There you go.
Oh, nice. Signed. Beautiful.
That's signed by our president and signed by myself on behalf of the college.
Thank you very much, Russ. Thank you. My pleasure. Thank you. Thank you, all of you, for coming.
And I want to thank Mary and Micah for setting up SciTech, and thank John and Sean for helping us, and the both of Michaels.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Yeah. Keep dreaming and keep hoping. Okay.